Channeling a spell. This is going to be a fire raga. It doesn't kill somehow, and it kills Nyad to land a kill. You.
Oh my god!
Here. Apparently not, because she is going for the back line. This is instant cast. He might have a chance. It is What's up, everybody? My name is Kason. Welcome back to the WDL. This is Season 4, Week 6 of the Wazette League, and you're going to notice my face is not on the screen. I am in a major rush to try and get this done really quickly so that this video isn't out, like, turbo late. So we're going to run through this with you guys. Let's take out those standings. Take a look at the standings. Meraxes and Izbar currently sitting at a 6-1 record, tied for first place right now. They have not played each other yet. They have looked dominant all season. Dervis currently sitting at 5-2. And three teams to follow up with 4-3 records right now. So if the season ended, those would be your playoff teams. Everybody with a winning record would make it. However, plenty of games to go yet. Four left for everybody in the league. We'll see if that changes things as Greatestness, Garrokin, Alcor, Tayo, Shadow, and Mao are all hungry for their opportunity to crack that top six. And we'll see how it goes. We've got six fights for you guys. Let's jump into them. Week number 6 of the Wazette League is kicking off here, and we've got Bagel Cats versus the Vanergen, Garrokin versus Shadow. Big to know here, Shadow, with only one more loss, would eliminate himself from the playoffs, and Garrokin here is trying to avoid a 3-loss streak after he picked up that huge win versus Izvar. So this is a big fight for both of these teams. On the side of Garrokin, we've got the Dialdo here, we've got Winter Luartha, and we've got McLeod. So this is the full Pierce team that we've seen have some success for him before. Will it work against Shadow, though, who has one of the most broken units in the game with the Black Rose Helena alongside Kreese and Yuni? Everybody getting their AoE buffs off. Zombie TMR here for the Yuni, so he has re-raise online. And we've got the fight like a pirate here. So a bunch of TMRs being used. With that Ferris TMR, Winter Luartha is going to be very, very speedy. And it looks like McLeod is going to follow suit here with a momentum. The King Bradley Trustmaster. Dialdo, does he make it 3-for-3 with another haste TMR? He does not. He's going to get his hate up. He's going to become tanky. 15,000 HP. Will it be enough here? As it looks like Black Rose Helena going to kick things off with a Rose Fulmination. So Limit Break coming out. Going to drop that magic attack resistance. 3,300 damage and the debuff. Dialdo tanked that very, very well. I would say one of the best we've seen from somebody tanking Black Rose Helena here. As Kreese is going to follow up with an arm shot, does it land the disable? It gets her own CT up. Couldn't see on the other side of the screen here. We don't know if Dialdo is disabled or not. Punishing Slow Arrow comes through. It looks like the disable is not there. So good news for Garrokin. However, this Dialdo is starting to be whittled down. He is now slightly below half HP. Winter Luartha is going to buff to increase her damage. And so is McLeod, but these two units are still not in range. And can Shadow's team take out this tank before the damage units get too close? Kreese is going to follow up with another arm shot. Another missile water chain going on here is very, very nice to amplify that damage. And Helena should be able to take this Dialdo out, I think, with the Maddening Verse. This time the disable actually did land, but it doesn't matter because Dialdo dies first anyway. And now, can these two damage units with tons of AP somehow turn this fight around? On the other side for Shadow, they should be fairly low on AP for these two units, and it looks like they're low on HP as well, as Yuni's going to drop, but the re-raise will bring him back. Does he have enough AP to get an arrow fallout? Yes, he does. 50 could be huge to get rid of this haste. It's going to exactly do that. So a little bit of chip, about 2k onto both. No more haste. This is looking quite good for Shadow to try and pick up his second win of the season. Can he pull it off? Black Rose Helena says yes, as she comes in with a Tri-Denervation, and now it is Winter Luartha versus the world. She's going to have to find a ton of AoE damage onto all three units here. Can she do it, as Kreese is going to walk up with a double shot sharp? She's not even going to get an opportunity. And that was a fantastic battle coming out from the Vanergan, coached by Shadow91. Like I said, only one win on the season before this fight, but that looked very, very impressive, and I would not have believed that if you told me after that fight. So very well done by him, and a huge congratulations for a second win. Next up to bat, we've got Elite versus Section 9. Section 9 already up near the top of the standings here, but Elite trying to join that Elite company if they can somehow pick up a win. This should be a good one. We've got a Keenblade coming out. We've got Agrius, Sylvie, and Astrius, a very interesting comp coming out from Dervis here, versus the full Axe team from Greatestness. who is going to get the better end of this deal, as it looks like some of that spirit debuff resist not really going to matter a whole lot against a full physical team. The big thing for Greatestness, does he get his physical barriers online for these two units? It's already a yes for the Halloween Lucio. Looking at the positioning though, Grifford could get baited out by a limit break here. Does he get an opportunity to do it, or does he just enter the fight? It's not even a limit break actually, it's a mortal draw for 1500 damage. Doesn't need to even heal him up since he was already full, and that is a bit rough for Greatestness here. As the cross destruction starts, it doesn't do a whole lot of damage, but with no barrier there, that is a good sign for Section 9. It looks like Sylvie should be able to go into offensive mode here with a clever Paladin Strike slash chain coming up, but the Halloween Lucille gets another dodge here, which is massive. Mirage Feint coming down, dropping the accuracy even further on the Agrius, but huge damage coming up from Agrius. Good lord! I did not expect that kind of damage. That was insane. Vampiric Riffer, though, is going to heal a lot of it back up. Cyrell going to try and make her mark on the fight here as she finally gets an opportunity. Frost Axe hitting both units. Sylvie and Agrius down for the count, and it is now Astrius versus 3. Does he have the accuracy? Does he have the damage to try and swing this? Tiger Maw is going to hit all three, but gets the barrier block for the Cyrell and dodged by the Lucio. Vacuum Slash going to hit back for 7k, and this looks like it is Greatestness' fight to win. He needs this desperately in terms of the standing. Surge Strike coming in for 5100. Dervis's Astrius is going to drop, and that was a very quick fight. It could have went either way, I think, if the buffs went a little differently. Shout out to Agrius for putting a ton of damage onto that Halloween Lucio, but ultimately that X team was just a bit too strong. And a huge win for Greatestness, who keeps himself in the thick of that playoff push. Next up, we've got Elda's Angels versus Royally Funked. Elda's Angels currently sitting at a 6-1 record, been crushing it all season, but Alcor, after starting out 0-4, has ripped off 3 straight wins. So we've got one of the top teams in the league versus one of the hottest teams. Who is going to pull this out? As it looks like it is Summer Glacella alongside Durando and Noctis from Alcor. A very cool comp to see, as it looks like Elda, King of the Lions, coming out from Isvar. Elda is his favorite unit. I am not surprised to see him. I think we're going to see him every single week, as it looks like Lorenzo is going to get that Keenblade going, which means Valade, looking at the turn order, should be able to get both of his buffs. Ice Vitalization is fantastic, getting that accuracy up, Protect, going to be very valuable against 3 physical units on the other side. The Wind Veritas TMR popped by the Durando, who is rocking almost 16,000 HP. His resistances aren't great, but his HP pool is massive, as the Starry Veil coming out from Valade. So this more, the OG more, TMR tech to nullify statuses from the other side can be a very valuable option here, as it looks like Elda's going to make his way over to the side, trying to get into range to deal damage. Lorenzo's channeling a spell. I have to assume this is a haste, has that really clutch time made sub to allow some of these increased speed of these big old units like Elda. And it looks like Summer Glassy's going to go Sunscreen, Elemental Chain Resistance, Protect. A very nice tech to try and mitigate damage from the physical side of the other team as well, as it basically the entire map is physical aside from Valade. But I don't know if he even really counts, as he almost never attacks the enemy team. Barb Blizzard comes out. Big old status upgrades, or stats upgrades, not status. Binding Javelin doing very little to that Durando, though. So it looks like building up a decent amount of Pierce Reds here. He does get immobilized, which means he's not going to be able to move. I do wonder if he's in range to hit or be able to get another buff off at least. As Noctis is out of buffs, he's going to make his way forward. Elda, King of the Lions, is too speedy, though. Going to go Binding Javelin again, but again, only 2,200 damage onto the Glacella. This is looking pretty decent for Alcor, as the prime unit of Isvar's team is not dealing a ton of damage. It's being mitigated quite well here. As Summer Glacella is immobilized, though, which means she's not going to get to act. Durando, do you have any range? Yes, you do. Vital Shot actually removes the haste, knocks him back a space, and 3,600 damage. He says, get the hell out of my face, buddy. As Noctis comes in, gives some more AP to both himself and Durando, and that will be a welcome sight here for Alcor, as Horizontal Jump comes in, does basically nothing to Noctis, and I am stunned by how well Alcor's team is mitigating this damage. Obviously, knowing that Isvar loves to run his Elda, Lion's Drain deals a decent amount and heals him back up to full, though. Obviously, Alcor running a lot of Pierce Res, but will it be enough? These immobilizes are taking a lot out of him, as Vital Shot hits for 4,200 on a crit, not bad. Lorenzo, though, can he try and remove any sort of Protect, re-raise? He can remove so many damn statuses with this skill. Armiger Assault, I haven't seen this limit break in an extremely long time. It is such a cool animation. 4,600 damage, gets the follow-up attack for 1,100, and they are starting to really whittle down this Elda, as there's 22 actions left, And just seeing, I'm calling that out because Alcor's team is quite bulky here. As the Dive of Destruction comes through for a little bit, Elda might be able to chain Pierce damage here though. Can he take out this Durando, or excuse me, Noctis, as his HP bar is not very high? No, he only goes for Cleansing Spear. He doesn't have the AP anymore. He's used too many skills up to this point. Durando hitting another Vital Shot, removes Haste again, but can't find the angle on the Elda, so he has to go for Lorenzo. I will say, Durando is kind of popping off as the Wolfen Claws come out and remove the re-raise. Not a lot of damage, but that could be huge as Lorenzo is going to take out his fellow Earthmate. Noctis is going to drop. Durando, does he get an opportunity to kill this Elda? No, Kirata is going to come in clutch here for 6,000 before Durando could take him out, which means he's going to target Lorenzo instead. Vital Shot for 3K. And Elda is just going to standard attack to get some AP. 2K onto the Durando on the crit, though, is pretty massive. And Alcor, I don't think they're going to have the damage to take out this Elda. Crash Edge coming out, so you can see how Alcor is building this team. That Leviathan VC giving Pierce Rise to the whole team, obviously using that skill from the VC. Very, very nice by Alcor, but I don't think it's enough. Elaid is going to be here to heal up these units. And you can mitigate all the damage you want, but unless you can kill him, it's not going to matter. Cleansing Spear comes out, kills the Durando, and Izvar, it looked rough for a little bit in this fight. But ultimately, it looks like he's going to pick up this win as they just need to get through this summer unit here. The slow coming out from the Lorenzo. Looks like he didn't have the AP or range to deal damage here. So he just tries to land the slow. It does not land. Valade's going to heal up the team to make it look like it was a more one-sided fight than it is. But honestly, this fight was actually quite close, even though it doesn't look it at the end here, as Glacial is going to slash with her sword, Noctis is going to skip his turn because he's dead, and Izvar is going to pick up another win on the season, moving to a 7-1 record. It's been impressive as hell, and GG to both of these players. Next up, we've got Nora's Gang versus Bento Box Bullies. Meraxis is one win away from clinching playoffs, and Mao has to win out to have a chance at making it. So a big game for both of these players, obviously for different reasons. One back against the wall, and the other one looking to make sure that their season keeps going after all the regular season battles are done. Claim the Flag coming out from Etra. So interestingly enough, that Summer VC here is being used, as it looks like the Reprieve from the Snow, the HP barrier is online for the Halloween Lucia, as the Wind Veritas TMR for Curry is being used. He will walk forward a few spaces, and I'm looking at the movement always on these bow units as it is three spaces, because you always wonder if they are going to run bow tie or not to keep themselves back. As that Unyielding Stance comes out from Tifa, so she's got the Courage. Automail's Crux is here for the Edward, but that Wind Veritas TMR is clutch versus him, as he will not have any AP restore here. The Store coming out from the Etra is going to make sure that her next hit hits like a damn truck, as it gives defense piercing, it gives increased attack. Frostmaw Barrage for 3,600, and the Frostbite, though, alongside the Wind Veritas TMR, this is Mao's angle. If he can just basically deplete the AP bar of Meraxis' team, that is how you win this fight. Smite 2 doing very little damage, also removing the debuff. Unfortunately, though, Etra does pick up that increased damage, as Overpower Plus is not enough to one-shot the Curry. That elemental disadvantage not paying dividends for Tifa here, as the Adamantine Pillar does 3,300, but Snow tanks that up quite well. Etra, though, getting the Frostbite, depletes some of her AP. She needs to do a lot with this fight, or with this attack. Fist of Frenzy and does 2K. It's not enough here. Curry, can he land another Frostbite on another target? No! Goes for the Sharpshoot. It looks like this is an evasive team coming out from Meraxis. We've seen him both in the WDL and Friday Night Fights pull out an evasive Etra, and I think that's what we are seeing, as Smite 2 is coming out from the Snow, which is, I believe, a guaranteed hit. That is why he's going for it. Same with Unhappy Ending, but now it is a 3v2 in the favor of Mao. Do they have enough guaranteed hits to get through this fight, and does Meraxis have enough damage to clean this up? Overpower Plus takes out the Curry. He is going to drop, so no more Frostbite, and that is a pretty huge deal here, as it looks like Edward's going to go next, and Tifa's going to lap. The Wallbreaker comes in to break that massive HP barrier for the Halloween Lucia. And Tifa, with 22 AP, is going to take out the tank. Halloween Lucia is up next. I think she has to toad the Edward to have a remote chance at winning this fight. Unless she does that, I think this is over. As Unhappy Ending goes for the Tifa instead, it's going to proc the Courage. Edward, with 20 AP, should be able to deal a decent amount here. Tiger Maw comes out for 3,600, and Tifa, can she clean up the fight? There's a dead body in the way, but she sidesteps it. She picks up a kill onto the Halloween Lucia. And unfortunate for Mao and Nora's Gang. I thought it was a really well-played strategy, but does not pick up the win, which means, unfortunately, Mao will be eliminated from the playoffs. But a huge congratulations to Meraxis who with, I think, three battles still remaining, clinches one of those top six spots. I know he is looking to try and pick up a first-round bye as well, but we'll have to see how it goes through the rest of the season. But GG to both of these players, and congratulations to the Bento Box Bullies. Two more fights remaining, guys, and we've got Witch of the Empire, coached by Tayo, rocking a full Sword Knight team with Howlett, Sternwing of Destiny, and Terra. Nemo on the other side, running his classic Barts alongside Montleonis, and this time Mustadio hanging around, as Mustadio pretty much picked up a win for Nemo single-handedly last week with a clutch Petrify, and I think he got a Reflex as well. Can he pull off some crazy stuff this week? Also, we'll have to see as the position for Prosperity comes out. Immortal Spirit for Terra on turn number one makes me wonder if Tayo is trying to pull any sort of Esper tech this week. A lot of times he does opt for that, but the fact that he goes for Courage on turn one, he's either thinking that the map is big enough for him to still do it, or he is not opting for that and playing a more traditional strategy here. We'll have to see, as it looks like the follow-up is online for Barts. He's going to move forward. Safeguard Plus from the Mustadio going to give effect, effect range up, essentially just means he can hit from further away. Also accuracy as well. Stern going to refresh AoE buff. Hazard Spell from the Howlett means he's going to take a little bit of his HP away in order to do more damage. There is the commune with Esper's tech, and it looks like the movement is 2 for Terra, I think. So she has a little bit of hate right now. Has the bow tie, and that is maybe so that Tile can make sure to get Courage and the Esper off. We'll have to see. As Destiny's Cross comes out from the Mont, he is nice and hasted up right now. And also with the Limit Break giving him so much CT, he's going to lap with himself. Killer Drain Blade. He is a tank, but he's dealing a good amount of damage. He also bled some of the AP from Tayo's Terra, but the Blade Blitz from the Bart is just devastating. It is an AP or AoE resist drop on the attack. Mustadio is going to come clean it up with a standard attack, and Stern, unfortunately, is all by his lonesome here. Convergence Plus is just going to tickle the Mont, and this was very, very well done by Nemo here as the Blade Blitz comes in. Montleonis should be able to get a slash chain going. I take it back. He decides to throw a rock at the Stern, but the follow-up comes in from Bard stealing additional damage, which means Mustadio should be able to claim this kill here with the standard attack. The re-raise is not there, as it looks like Tayo is going to drop to the hands of Nemo. Lion's Guard is going to be victorious in this fight. It was very, very well done, and a huge congratulations. Last fight of the week, guys, should be a banger. We've got Lightning Warriors versus Eggplant Brigade. Two teams currently sitting at a 4-3 record, searching for that playoff spot. They got to these records by very different methods. We'll have to see who pulls off this victory, as it looks like on the side of Meeple, we've got the Glacial Flagbearer, we've got Ravies, and we've got Liarte. On Hisoka's side, we've got the Soul, Balo, and Mia. So we have a R rarity unit on both sides of the field right here. We have a low-cost tank with Balo and Ravies, and we've got one super-powered unit with Glacial Flagbearer and Soul. So who's going to get the better end of this deal? We're going to have to find out as the Keenblade comes out from the Balo. He is going to start walking forward. The Soul is going to be up next, going to start channeling a spell here. Mia, does she have any more buffs left? She does not. She really doesn't have much in her kit unless she has the Spellblade sub-job equipped, as Beacon of Reform coming out from the Glacella. And she's going to start walking forward as well. 11,000 HP. She is very, very healthy here. Courage online for the Ravies, and she's going to try her damnedest to tank this damage. Balo does have the elemental advantage. Pyre of Chaos and Destruction. Holy shit. 12,000 damage just obliterates the Ravies. And that is not good news here for Meeple, as Balo is going to go Sapping Sword, proccing the Courage. And man, oh man, Mia might just be able to clean up this kill right here. Slow poke. It doesn't matter how slow you are. She is fast enough to claim this kill here. She's going to kill the Ravies. It is a 3v2, an advantage of Hisoka. Liarte going to channel. Is this a charm charge? Yes, it is. The charm lands. That could be huge, except I think Balo has hate. No, it doesn't matter. The charm effect, I think, changed. So now Glacella goes for the Mia instead. This could be actually pretty big if they're able to basically avoid this tank. But good lord, Soul comes in and damage caps the Liarte here for 14k, essentially. The Slowpoke is going to drop the unit attack resist, but Balo is going to turn on his team here. Trinity Burst is not quite enough to kill the Mia, and Soul is going to try and take out this Glacella. Pyre of Chaos and Destruction just crushes her here, as that barrier is doing nothing from that skill here, as Mia going to follow up with a Slowpoke, not enough to deal the killing blow. And Glacella is going to get lapped by this soul. 5,700 damage comes through. And for a second, it looked like there might just be a tiny bit of hope with the charm. But that team from Hisoka and the Eggplant Brigade was just too much to overcome. So huge congratulations to him, guys. Let's check out the standings. All right, guys, week 6 in the books for the Wazette League. This is how the standings shake out. We're going to notice two teams have clinched playoffs, and one team, unfortunately, has been eliminated from playoffs. Meraxis and Izvar, to the surprise of absolutely nobody. Bento, Box Bullies, and Eldest Angels, currently sitting at 7-1, have not played each other yet. Whoever wins that battle is very likely to be the first seed. The loser might still be the second seed, but some of these other teams might have something to say about it, as Eggplant Brigade, Section 9, and Lion's Guard, all currently sitting at 5-3. And to note here, all three of those teams have played each other already. Hisoka is 2-0 against Dervis and Nemo. Nemo has lost to both of them, and Dervis obviously beat Nemo and lost to Hisoka. So those three have a very clear tiebreaker right now as to who would be third, fourth, and fifth. Meeple and Greatestness currently sitting at 4-4 each, so both of those teams are tied for sixth, and they have not played each other yet. So the winner of that battle, it could be pretty huge in terms of who makes the playoffs. Garokin and Alcor are not out of it at a 3-5 record, only technically one game out from the playoffs, but noting that Meeple and Greatestness, one of the teams is guaranteed a victory, it's very likely that Garokin and Alcor, one of these two teams, has to win out to make it. And Tayo and Shadow 91, the absolutely 100% have to win out to make it to 5-6. There's weird scenarios where they could win a tiebreaker over either Meeple and Greatestness, whoever wins that one, if they were to only end up 5-6. But basically to make it, a lot of teams are going to have to like lose all of their games, basically. So it's a long shot, but you're telling me there's a chance. And Mao, coach of Nora's gang, unfortunately falling to 1-7. Can still play spoiler to some of the teams remaining, though, and I'm sure he is looking forward to doing that. So, guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you enjoyed the battles. I said this in another video. Next week, there will be no WDL videos. I'm going to be on vacation. I'm going to be in Florida. It's going to be a great time. I'm looking forward to it. But the week after that, look forward to more battles coming out for all four leagues. I'm excited about it. And until then, guys, have a wonderful day.